let's look at the last 10 years, 10 and a half years, and what it has meant for India, Indians. But one has to look at the whole Hindutva project and the proto-fascist, pro-corporate project that we are looking at, not just in the context of course, the primary target, which is the major religious minority, which is the Muslims, but also in terms of kind of completely upturning a fledgling Republican constitutional democracy and what it has meant. I'd also like to flag the issue that this election was conducted in extremely extenuating circumstances. I don't think we can afford to forget that one of the greatest assaults by this regime, which is very proudly calls itself a Hindutva regime, which wants to move towards a Hindu nation, has been the assault on India's institutions. On March 16th, I think a couple of days before the elections were announced, a few days prior to that, one of our election commissioners, Arun Goel, actually resigned his post under mysterious circumstances. We do not know the reasons to date. Two election commissioners were appointed just before the announcement of polls, and they joined the election commission on March 15, 2 days before the elections were announced. One of them had worked very, very closely with the Home Minister of India during his tenure as a bureaucrat, and the other had worked under the Chief Minister of Uttarakhand, also a BJP elect. Interestingly, the manner of selection completely abused and overturned the Supreme Court verdict of November 2023, which had specifically directed that the Chief Justice of India and the leader of the opposition must be consulted. The regime made a complete farce of this consultation. And 6 hours before, I think the LOP was given a list of maybe 200 people. Next day, it was shortlisted to six. It was a completely farcical exercise. So in this backdrop, we had an election conducted over seven phases, irrationally declared through a very, very hot summer, with decreasing polling percentages. And of course, no press conference held at all by the election commission, which is normally the practice after every phase, before every phase. Doubts arose about the failure of the election commission to actually release the percentage numbers of votes polled within a few hours of polling. But they were not given. They were given 5 days, 6 days, even 11 days later. I'd also like to flag what a couple of opposition leaders said in Parliament in the special session that was held for the budget before the monsoon session. Manoj Jha of the RJD talked about a complaint that his party had given to the Election Commission on after the first phase on April 19th. They received a reply only after the conclusion of polls, just telling you how robust this complaint mechanism is. Mahua Moitra of the TMC said that we won in spite of the Election Commission, not because of it. A recent report by a Human Rights Watch has just summed up what we have been complaining about, because CJP and many organizations in India have complained about the obnoxious levels of hate speech made by the star campaigners of the Bharatiya Janata Party, including the Prime Minister and the Home Minister and many other functionaries against which the Election Commission did not act. The kind of issues that were thrown to the fore this election, look back at India in January 2024, when the Ram Mandir inauguration happened, and we know why it was time for Jan 22nd. There was a sense of foreboding that we didn't have a completely put together opposition. We did not really know what the issues were going to be and what this will mean for the religious minorities, for Dalits, for Adivasis and the marginalized sections, because of the kind of hate that is going to be unleashed during election, which was even tried this time, but it did not work. The most important issues that came to the fore were the actually real issues that affect the lives of millions of Indians: joblessness, rising inflation, the agrarian crisis. These were the real issues that seemed to drive not just the voter and the people, but also the opposition and their agenda. And which is why the popular slogan that one kept hearing about was the Constitution, which was a huge sense of relief for many of us. And we hope that this does not remain a hollow slogan and actually translates into making the Constitution and its values, which are in fact incompatible with many of the weaponized laws that have been passed, not just by this regime, but more egregiously by this regime, but even by previous regimes, and actually repeal of those laws and actually realization of a socio-economic reality which actually is in tune with the constitutional vision and mandate. Will the opposition actually push and drive that agenda still? I think the challenge now is for forces within society, all of us human rights defenders, and of course the opposition parties, to actually deliver on some of the not just noises, but on the articulations during the election campaign, and some things concerning, say, the Congress manifesto, where an article I wrote where I said that actually a party in crisis like the Congress appears to have gone back to its original mandate of 1931 and 1924. Will that actually happen? And that's something which is, I think, we need to push, we need to look out for. Has the Hindutva core agenda vanished from public discourse and from its electoral hold on Indians? There's not enough time to go, you know, into state-wise figures, but I'd just like to flag that India is a very, very, very vast country. And even if you look at the way the BJP and RSS did in states like Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala, there'll be differences. So we need to keep remembering that when we try to make a countrywide analysis and assessment. Maybe we'll have future conversations when one can do that. But just to say that the very regressive politics and a regressive ideology that has been given institutional legitimacy over the last 10 years particularly, but even that institutional legitimacy had begun before with the infiltration by certain mindsets into the police, into law enforcement, into different other institutions of governance, remains a big challenge. So it's not something that we can wish away, and it requires a very long haul battle, very concerted battle, and a certain clarity of conviction, where we also recognize that the Dalit, Bahujan, Adivasi is also central to this discourse. And if we look at the future kind of relationships on the subcontinent, the issue of religious minorities will need to be there and will need to be flagged, not just religious minorities, but also Dalits, Namo Shudras, etc. Thank you very, very much.